Today, I will take time to call Mr. Arora Saab immediately, TC Arora, who has been the former director of Toshiba, who's seen a lot of development in the country, including Ultra Mega. He was also responsible for the joint venture that was initiated between the JSW Toshiba. So let's have Mr. TC Arora give us his views and enlighten this audience of where do we go on the, especially the thermal power development side and the Ultra Mega sides.
Thank you, Professor. Gentlemen sitting on the dais and colleagues. Well, we, since morning, have been hearing divergent views on the capacities, on the policies, but we talk about the fuel, without which I don't think planning done by 10th plan or 11th plan or 12th plan, there have been slippages and will continue to slip if we don't do anything on fuel. Especially, I'm only talking in respect of the coal. We have the coal ministry, we have many ministries, many things are there, but in other areas we have the regulator, but why don't we have a regulator for the coal? That's very strange. Now, if we have the coal regulator, maybe then we would have not bothered what CAG has said. As I really encourage the DPS to be made 28 in one night, the allocation was also made 28 in one night.
More than that. Allocation was made 113.
So in that sense, we can be very fast in certain decisions and then we can keep on sitting on certain decisions for decades. So that's the way we have been working, and that's beside the point whether we call it a policy framework is wrong, or the people at the helm of affairs are wrong, or the public, or the bureaucrats, or the technocrats, or the business people. But actually, we have failed miserably. But if you go from 6th plan to 7th plan to 8th plan to 9th plan, there was only one manufacturer who was a dominant, and he had a limited capacity, so our yearly growth was also limited. So the people, whether in the manufacturing, whether in transmission or in distribution or in fuel mining, was limited to that kind of capacities. But as we increase our plan capacities to go from 25,000 megawatt to straight away to 70,000 megawatt, that was good for generation. But unfortunately, power sector is not limited to generation capacities. If we don't do anything on the transmission, we don't do anything on the fuel, we don't do anything on the distribution, or on the what the capacity generation can do. And that is what we have seen. People are very happy that in 11th plan we could go 55,000 megawatt. But please consider 9th and 10th plan slippages. They have come in 11th plan. It's not the 11th plan alone which has given 55,000 megawatt. Coming to 12th plan, which is already started, and we have not done much on that, and slippages of 11th plan will give a fruitful results in the 12th plan. But what about its own 12th plan, 78,000 megawatt, and somewhere people are saying 94,000 megawatt with a base scenario or with a high gas scenario or with a high gas and a renewable scenario. So even if you consider that, about 65 to 70,000 megawatt has to come from thermal, and coal would be the dominant. Gas, we do not know, because as such today, our gas plants are not running more than 50 to 60% PLF. It doesn't make sense to run those gas plants at 60% PLF when your fuel cost is 70%. So in that sense, we have to depend upon coal. Now, people are saying it's about 600 million ton capacities. Okay, we take that 540 to 600. But if you consider what is the requirement by 12th plan, the coal production, it's about 1,100 million tons we require. Now, 1,110 and 600, it's a 500 million tons. Today we have a 200 million ton short gap. In the next 4 years, we're going to have 500. How are you going to get it? So we will be very happy we acquired coal mines in South Africa or Indonesia. There are issues in Indonesia for 35-40%. The coal mines have been acquired in Indonesia from where the people have to first bring it to the barge, then to the ship, and then bring it to India. And then there is no breakers or unloading facilities. So we solve one problem, but we're not able to solve the next problem. So I think it has to be seen as a complete sector, not alone on a generation or the fuel availability or transport or kind of things. Now, as you said, everything has to be done for the public good. Now, public good is whether it is on the consumer good or a sector good. Now, if we talk about welfare for all, then it will bring the efficiency. But if we only talk about the consumer good, then everybody will go back to the financial model and talk about the return on the equity. So that's a conflict. Unless we solve this conflict of welfare of the sector, which brings the efficiency in the operation of the sector as a whole, starting from the land acquisition to the consumer point. But if you only talk in isolation in fuel or in manufacturing, it's not going to bring results. Now, how do we bring those things together? Now, even if we consider power sector as a loan from generation, transmission, and distribution, still certain things can be done. We can have an interaction with the other ministries. But coming back to the point where we have discussion, because if we can keep on talking about the interrelated ministries, and they will never come to any point, and that's what we are facing. So I don't feel ashamed of saying this thing, that the people in this ministries, people in the public, have failed this sector miserably. We can't find solutions that we have to give a cheaper power to the farmers. Who's really getting the power? Are those people who have to wake up at midnight, 2 o'clock in the night, to run their pumps, and daytime they don't get the power? Are we doing anything for them? Nothing. So as you rightly said, the 4% or 17% is enjoying the benefits, but rest of the people are not enjoying the benefits. So in that sense, we have failed in our policies, and if the public media or the people who are putting these things out, it is need to be seen. We should not question their authority or the points why they are saying this thing. Either you fail them by proving that they were wrong and deliver the results. That also is not being done either by the technocrats or by the bureaucrats or by the even the business houses. So we all are responsible for this. Let's not put one party be responsible for it. Now coming to your coal fuel, I only link it to the planning megawatts which is to be generated in the 12th plan. By the end of 2017, even if I go by 96,490 megawatts, out of which about 68 to 70,000 megawatt will come into the coal, now which will require approximately 1,055 million tons of coal capacity. Now, even if we generate capacities, are we ready to transport those facilities, the coal, whether inland or by are ports ready for that, or even from one side of the India to the other side, why don't we use inland waters, why don't we use the sea, why don't we increase the dedicated freight corridors for the coal? People are always saying the same thing on the FDI. It should have happened, 4,000 megawatt, the tariff should have gone down. But if the projects do not come, and you continue to use the diesel or some other sources and generate the power at three times or four times the tariff, so it is really not helped. So I'm slightly going away from the topic on the policy, but actually it is, we can continue to give a data, we can continue to give the slippages, but I think it's to do with a coordinated effort by the policy makers. If, as you rightly said, go situation. Now, a person who has planned to put up a power plant, he gets the investors, he also gets the manufacturer to bring the technology, and some fine day, somebody says, okay, this is no-go situation. Where does he go? So these kind of things have to be thought. I was trying to make a joint venture when I was in Toshiba, we were talking to the ministry that, okay, if somebody's going to bring the money, he's going to bring the technology, what is the assurance you're giving on the business? So then they came out with this bulk orders, and it created some kind of a business for them. And then you get five manufacturers, Now, all fingers are not same. Everybody has got. There are players who have set up the factories, are at advanced stage of completion of the factories. They may not be able to get all the orders, but people who have not even purchased the land, but only on paper, they have taken more orders. So we are in the same situation again, whether it's ultra, mega, or bulk orders. So who is going to lose? The public and the face of the ministry. And as somebody said, that we are becoming a laughing stock. I mean, I believe that if we can do much better globally in policy making or analysis, why can't we analyze in our own country? And I think this, you don't need any MBA or any specialization to analyze these kind of things, why it is not happening. So I think with this, I have already said a lot of things about the policy. I'll leave it to this, and we will talk more on the manufacturing when that thing comes. Thank you so much.
You know, I would request Mr. Sunil Parwani, Additional General Manager from BHL, to take the dais, please, along with all of us. Please welcome him.
Thank you, Prof, and very distinguished members on the dais, distinguished colleagues. I would take the liberty of venturing into areas a bit away from coal, if it's permitted. I would also try to restrict my presentation to about 15 minutes, as is mentioned in the schedule. I'll devote the first 7 minutes or so to where we are on the power sector, the complete value chain of power, and the next 7 minutes to dwell on some of the issues, of course, have been raised, and they might be repetitions. Where are we today? Incidentally, if you go to the Ministry of Power website, you'll still notice in bold letters there that they say the mission 2012. Now we are probably at the end of 2012, and it says mission 2012, power for all. And it says a comprehensive blueprint for power sector development has been prepared, encompassing an integrated strategy for the sector development with following objectives: sufficient power to achieve GDP growth. He's mentioned about 0.5% of GDP is impacted already today by lack of power. And my guess is it's a little more than 0.5%. It says reliable power. Now, those of us who are from Delhi and North India know how reliable the power has been in the last few months. Quality of power, optimum power cost, tariffs, commercial viability of the power industry, and at the end it says power for all. Now, 30% of India's population lives without power, has never seen electric power. The vision was to electrify all the villages. I believe 90-odd% of the villages have been electrified, but the people living in the villages have not got the wires to their little shanties. So 30% of the people still live without power, and I think, as Professor was saying, this is and T.C. Arora was very rightly elaborating, this is completely ambivalence of policies on infrastructure. Not just power, and power is one of the elements of infrastructure. There's a complete ambivalence of policies, call it paralysis if you wish, on infrastructure policies. And I would like to reserve my comments on the CAG, because that poor man is really not responsible for all the policy paralysis that's going on in this country. So that poor man has made some comments here and there, but the paralysis is just frightening. So where are we? We have a peak deficit of 12,000 megawatt. Is that right, Ashwini? About 10.5%. And energy deficit also about 8-9%. Where are we today? Each and every single plan which has happened has fell short by 50% or so, except a plan called the seventh plan, which met its target. Seventh plan had a 22,000 and odd target, and 21,000 and odd was met, about 96% was met. Eighth plan, 30,000, 16,000 done. Ninth plan, 40,000, 19,000 done. Tenth plan, 41,000, 21,000 done. 11th plan, by the way, had 78,000. We talk of 60,000 because that was the media target. It was not the plan target. Plan target was 78,000 against that. We did 55. 55 is a reasonable figure, but yet it's only 60% or so of the target. The 12th plan, I think, has 75,000 and all. And the 13th plan, they're talking of 93,000. So really, there are issues around this, and I'll come to the issues in the second part of my comments. The fourth issue which I want to flag is the fourth point on where are we. We are and will continue to be, as Professor and all my other colleagues have said, basically a coal-driven energy society. Even in the 12th plan, for 75,000 and odd megawatt, 63,000 and odd is thermal, and out of which I think 62, 60, gas is about just about 1,000 megawatt. So all the balance 62,000 and odd is coal-based. Supercritical, which is about 38%. Of the total, and subcritical, that will be 62%. So we are not progressing on hydro, not much on nuclear, because there are issues. There are genuine issues, but that's where policy comes in. And that's where good implementers have taken action in other countries. Renewable energy is one step in which could give a boost. And in fact, in the 12th plan, it is planned that something like 18,500 megawatt of renewable energy will be contributed. But I quite agree with the professor that our potential is far, far in excess, and we can do much, much better than just 18,500 megawatt in the 12th plan. The next issue is, of course, coal, because that is in everybody's mind, from Mr. Jaiswal to Mr. Power Minister, to the Prime Minister, to Mr. S.K. Srivastav and Mr. Umashankar. Everybody is obsessed with coal these days. So do pardon me, because my figures are also based on the Planning Commission figures that says that in 2016-17, the power sector is going to require 842 million tons. It would still have a shortage of 238 million ton. At a 15% blending, perhaps you will be importing 140 to 150. So there will be a net shortage. The AT&C losses, which were 39%, have only come down to 27% in the last 10 years. The target is 15%, and as Ashwini showed in his slide earlier, actually the global standard is 5%. But we set a modest target of 15%. We are nowhere close to it, and nowhere seem to be getting close to. What can we do? It is both loss in transmission and loss in revenue. That is what A plus B adds to AT&C loss. I think the solutions lie in the smart grids, which this group has been debating. 100% metering and a complete commitment to the fact that the consumer has to pay for what he consumes. Cross-subsidy between industrial, domestic, and agricultural is, to my mind, a source of huge discomfort. Today the DISCOM debt has risen to almost 2 lakh crore. Just to revamp the distribution network in this country, we require an investment of 3,06,000 crores in the 12th plan itself, which kind of money probably would be very difficult to come by. And to my comments on what could we do on generation, on coal, on transmission and distribution, I would like to add just one more factor, which is that distributed generation has to be encouraged, because there are great numbers of our population, people living in remote areas, where they do not have a wire going to their house. Obviously, distributed generation, renewable energy, and solar. These are the solutions. We have committed 20 gigawatt, but then 20 gigawatt in about 12 years, which is the National Solar Mission target. And there are a lot of lessons to be derived from excellent work being done in the state of Gujarat in solar. In fact, it's interesting to note that Gujarat has done more solar projects than the National Solar Mission, which has been launched by the central government of India. And Gujarat is completely racing ahead of the rest of the country. So there'll be in renewables, it'll be in solar, it'll be Gujarat and the rest of the country. So another fact which I want to place before you, that certain European countries, and these include Germany, France, Italy, last year, 2011, they added more than 6,000 megawatt of simply solar photovoltaic energy to their grids. Imagine we have not been able to add that much, all our energy sources put together. So my point is, those of us who are apprehensive about solar, I just like to make this submission that it's completely doable, it's been done, and is continuing to be done globally. And to my mind, this could be one of the solutions in reaching power to all, as we say. So those were some of my comments on the issues and what need to be done, what could we be doing to the three segments of power generation, power transmission, and power distribution. And to that, I would like to place the extra layer of renewables and solar. Thank you.
I would like to make a small comment on this pass-through. I would like to caution you, gentlemen. This is a very dicey situation. Pass-through is easy said than done. Unless you link pass-through to a efficiency parameter, what will happen in the pass-through? There are two situations can occur. A inefficient power station, old one, using domestic coal, or a good power station cost-based using imported coal, where mines have been owned out of taken, concession taken of a poor quality, and coal being overpriced. This is bound to happen because pass-through tariff, it is a, what ultimately what you're going to achieve. Today, what the airline is doing, the whole tariff is passed through at one STF, ATF, BTF, so many charges. A basic, when you ask for a fare, basic fare is 1280, and you end up paying 9,000 rupees for the ticket. So pass-through tariff is not so simple unless you fix A, the efficiency parameters, B, the quality parameter coal which, at what price you are doing, and C, the coal which is coming from the source of supply, the cost of, one is sale price, one is the cost price. You are really leveraging the coal producer to increase the price unbridled, because you have no choice. And you are putting your situation virtually in their hands, since you are free, it will be passed through. So I think unless you get a proper regulation, somebody mentioned about core regulator. I forgot to mention in my core regulator today. I mean, it's most welcome thing. But if you bring coal regulator today with 90% coal coming from the Coal India or Singareni mines, poor fellow has to depend on their mercy for their transport, for their office, for his own salary even sometimes. What to say of his facilities in his home. He's not going to really become effective. So pass-through is very easy to, there's no expression or no hard feelings. Let's sit down and work out a pass-through formula.
Right.
So pass-through has to be linked to certain basic parameters which should be transparent, quantifiable, and then pass-through will make sense.
Right. So basically it is a, you know, I would say it's a price variation formula, you know, when you have a, rather than the pass-through, and then price discovery. See, there is a price discovery. There is always a price discovery in every situation.
No, no, pass-through is, base price has to be established. Now, like in this PPA, which we are signing today, even the by the bidding process, the buying the power, you have the provision for pass-through on the freight charges. Suppose the railway increases the freight. That is adjustable as a price variation clause.
Exactly.
Similarly, the Coal India raises the coal price, where the coal linkage is there. But pass-through in sense of imported coal, you see, the problem is where there is no base established, you cannot have a pass-through. And pass-through, we can't go back and say, again, the cost-plus basis, it is not possible. It's an international bidding. The power purchase is being purchased through the bidding process. There you have certain factors where the PVC is allowed.
Exactly.
Even it was allowed in when the Mudra was bid, Mudra, the developer was to suggest. It was open to the developer to suggest the fixed cost, the variable cost, where he wanted a variable. But everybody wanted to quote a higher fixed cost to recover the money and less of the variable cost, and that made them greedy for not doing this on the imported coal. Because domestic coal, you know, the price is not going to be increased. So there was not much difference. Imported coal, if the price would have continued like what it was at that time, it would have been difference of $5 or $6, nothing would have happened. But it had been jumping. So that is why the price was so high.
I don't differ with all that. All I am cautioning you, the danger of
pass-through concept can never come in this country now. Because when you have a bidding process, the pass-through is
taken care of.
And in meanwhile, I just want to tell this forum, you know, who is over here, and we would like to include, that there is a very interesting figure, that there is an alternative reserve in coal, and that is the Director General of Hydrocarbons has estimated that India's coal bed methane capability is 1400 to 2600 BCM, you know, billion cubic meters, and that is massive. So this is another area, and it will take a longer time to look at this, but I think this is definitely a direction that the country must take when we are discussing this issue for thermal power.
I would like to caution here also, gentlemen, it's very, very important to note. I don't know how many of you are aware, when you start a coal bed methane extraction well, the first 3 to 4 years, the well delivers only water, and that too potable water of very high quality. And most of the areas, we are already water deficit. A, B, the water tables get damaged beyond repair. In Canada, because of the social pressures, most of the coal bed methane wells have been stopped after working 10, 12, 14 years. Because the water loss, unlike natural gas, because you know, coal bed reservoir is different, that they absorb gas in coal. And to release, you have to fracture it, and then the hydraulic pressure which is comes, that sucks it out. So first 3 years, 4 years, the only water comes out. The gas rises slow, then water stabilizes, water comes down, the gas goes up. The loss of water, which we cannot afford, if you have the cost analysis of losing water and additional coal bed methane resource, what you get, that is one part. Second part, the coal bed methane resource is very strangely, because having dealt with the subject, I want to share with you. The some area of it, like Great Eastern, have succeeded because there is area is not mined at all. And once you start extracting coal bed methane, now coal bed methane, I mean methane with a vertical hole. Right. There's nothing wrong in to extract methane along with the working mine.
Horizontal.
That's called CMM and AMM.
Yes.
Associated mine methane, abundant mine methane, coal mine methane. That's the best method because that is safest. You're not disturbing the water table. You're going along. The rate of extraction is less.
Right.
But every ounce, every, I would say, molecule of gas is utilized, you can. But be careful by going blindly by DGS numbers of reserve. Reserve we have, no question. Center of the earth contains that Nife, nickel and iron, molten. That can last for billions of years. But we can't extract even an ounce of that. So coal bed methane in our situation, socioeconomic, population, requirement, a water deficit country. Most of the coal fields are water deficit. Coal bed methane alone is not the solution. It has to come associated mine methane. You extract coal, what is called methane drainage. At very low cost, you can extract and more mine safer. So yes. That, by simply having those numbers, because those numbers have been derived, you know how? My coal contains 10 cubic meters of gas per ton. I've got resource of 293 billion. 10 into 293, that finger will...
Right. No, basically, it's a trigger. The trigger is, I understand what you're saying. But I'm saying these discussions will start. The starting point of this, we have to look at extracting methane and using it as well. It's as simple as that. It is okay. We don't label. It's like the globalization word. You know what happened in management? Now today, globalization is the word of the pariahs. Nobody wants to use that word. But globalization is a good word, good idea. But what have you done with globalization today? You've finished everything. So nobody wants to use it in the management schools. So therefore, I'm not per se saying coal bed methane. Look at extracting methane from coal. So if we correct that, you know, but we're very clear. You know, we have not been looking at this. I'm saying it's an opportunity which has gone missing. And if we start today, from 10 to 15 years from now, we'll be in a better situation. You know, I'm talking of let's look at research. Let's look at allowing research in this direction.
Nothing more on this.
Yeah.
When we talk about the ultra mega power projects with supercritical technology,
right.
We also need to also look at the quality of the coal.
Exactly.
If we are giving a grade dive with 45 and 50% ash content,
then forget about it.
Forget about it.
Right.
Today that has been sorted out. I think, let me tell you, the Ministry of Environment already has circulated for public opinion. Last date was 15 September. Unless they have extended, I suggested them to extend by 1 month. Have they extended it? No. See, the now new mandate is coming from April 1, 2014 that no coal which has a heat value of less than 4,000 kilocalories shall be transported beyond a distance of 500 kilometers. A, this is one part of the story. Second part, a coal beneficiation policy. I'm a member of the committee which is headed by coal secretary. We are trying to work out a policy that all coals should be beneficiated.
Good.
So that no wasteful material or no non-burnable material to the extent it can be economically separated is taken or transported by spending extra energy. So that portion has been already in the site. In fact,
kilometer issue has already been implemented?
Not too long back, June 1, 2002. Actually it was June 1, 2000, got delayed by 2 years. June 1, 2002. Now from April 1, 2014 or January 1, 2014, I don't remember. I think April 1, 2014, 500 kilometers is there. And that's why I was trying to develop this idea of, you call it UMPP, you call it merchant terminal, power plants. Put the power plant close to the mine, as close as possible. And then import coal for the region where you can easily use them.
That's right.
That was the objective. That we don't stay in our infrastructure, but the quality aspect. Now here is a commercial transparency. See what happens when if I go to buy any vegetable, I pick and choose because I know what value I'm paying. There I equally blame the users, you know. I mean, if you demand quality, they will have to give you. You know, for single man crusade I am carrying from 78. I agree, but still.
Then you can use this.
No, but still, today also, Bhavani ji, today also, you know, you can do it. You have to demand.
Today, the man who is
so, may I request Mr. Vishwanathan to immediately come over And I would like him to also comment on what he saw with the other speakers and
delegates. I'm from the manufacturing sector, so I would like to focus on the challenges that the power sector faces with respect to the manufacturing and the technological aspects which we bring to the table to address these challenges. That's what my focus is going to be. Fundamentally, one thing is clear, that the coal which is going to be fired in the power plant cannot be defined as a single composition, analysis, or a variety. Even if you take an Indian coal, it varies in quality from one seam to the other seam, even from the same mine. And leave alone the import. When you talk about import, again the coal quality is not entirely in our hands. So when a power plant is conceived and put up, definitely the owner of the plant is going to specify certain fuel, and that's what the manufacturing sector is going to work with in coming up with a design and make the plant operate. But eventually, what plays a key role in ensuring a high PLF to the plant and is going to be what kind of tolerances that one envisages, whether specified or not. And this is where a big difference comes. Obviously, a plant like UMPP, where the efficiencies are high, would probably use high calorific value coal. It is not necessarily the case for the rest of the plants. So if you see the average power plant in the whole of the country, it has to be designed for the worst of the operating conditions, taking into account the variations that are possible in a life of, let's say, 25 to 30 years in the power plant. So what a manufacturing unit does in designing the boiler, which faces the maximum variation in the coal quality. If you take any other equipment in the plant, it may not face it so much, but boiler does. So when a boiler is, the design of the boiler is developed, the worst case scenario is conceived in designing not only the boiler components, but also the auxiliaries. Because most of the abuse is taken by the auxiliaries. You take pulverizer, you take fan, you take the electrostatic precipitator. So these are the equipment which, apart from the boiler itself, which are going to be stressed the most. So the design has to be developed in a rugged fashion. It does mean indirectly that the cost is going to be higher. And most importantly, when you factor in the fact that today a lot of Chinese equipment are coming in, we all know one fact, whether said or not, the design is standardized for the Chinese equipment. So the equipment is designed with air design irrespective of the coal. And specifically, even if you specify a coal to them, my experience in dealing with different producers is the design does not change from China. You give the same design, whether it is coal A, coal B, coal C, or any other coal. And they do sign on the dotted line, and the supply is made with the same configuration. There are standing examples in the industry where power plants supplied have not fulfilled their obligations, they have not performed, and the user is the sufferer finally, and of course, the consumers like us. So where internal sourcing is done, self-reliance is ensured by not only producing a design which is customized to the needs, and even customized beyond the needs specified openly. That's where the ruggedness and the sustainability comes in. So we from the manufacturing sector, what would like to assure is the design is made in a much more far-reaching manner to factor in the variables that are likely to come in terms of coal, and the longevity of the boiler and the PLF of the plant is going to be ensured with this kind of an approach. We talked about lignite briefly. I want to respond very briefly to that. It's not the sulfur in lignite alone, that's a problem. The problem with lignite are many more, like very high moisture, very low calorific value. So these things do add to the problem. And there are certain lignites which are also abrasive in nature, the ash content in the lignite. If you take the lignite from the south, from Neyveli, the ash content is very less. If you take lignite from Bhavnagar and other Gujarat areas, the ash content is quite significantly higher. All these things do have a role to play in sizing the boiler big enough. So the problems of lignite are not coming from sulfur alone. Sulfur could be a non-issue in certain issues, in certain situations. It could be factored in a different way. But the size of the boiler, yes, it does matter when it comes to lignite. And the reasons are more to do with the other characteristics of lignite. And when it comes to supercritical, the manufacturing capacity is going to be a very key ingredient to making a successful production of a big power plant. And we, from our company's JEC, have been working in the direction of setting up an expansion of our existing manufacturing capability, which is currently working on the subcritical target. We have made provisions to go beyond subcritical to the supercritical range, and the machineries, the size of the plant that is needed is all being worked out in a blueprint. In a short time from now, maybe a year or so, we would be in a position to expand our manufacturing facility in Yamunanagar to cater to the needs of a supercritical power plant as well. And the other part of the technology to address the supercritical, or UMPP for that matter, is metallurgy. With the advancement of available material and the various testing, metallurgical testing and advances made in the welding and also production of the material, today a temperature of 600 degrees centigrade has become a normal thing. The temperature more than 600, where we really call it as ultra-supercritical, is also being made possible with the advancement of metallurgy. So combined with the availability of superior materials, well proven, and the design approach which takes care of the worst case scenario in terms of coal mainly, makes I would say a supercritical or UMPP quite feasible in the long run. And the reliance on the internal sourcing would add to this, because after sales service support can be taken for granted, which is not going to be the case when an imported equipment comes from wherever it is, more so from China. You do not know what kind of reliance you can put on the availability of after sales service. So with these few words, I just want to put up a very small statement here that we are, as a manufacturing sector as a whole, well prepared to support the development of UMPP, taking into account duly the variables associated with coal as a fuel. Thank you.
In fact, Mr. Vishwanathan has put it very rightly, that how the Indian industry is completely prepared to take the next leap. And as we rightly said, you know, we would go for making India a literal manufacturing base for advanced technology, including supercritical and ultra-supercritical. So that could be the scenario. Rodasa would agree with this?
Yeah, I thought we discussed that.
I know. Right.
That's why.
So we'll come. We have a very full session. We have two ideas, as you saw in the program, a Chinese onslaught in this after the lunch. We'll talk about anti-dumping. I would put that issues up here. It's already up. We have brought to a level where 21% anti-dumping duty is under not only active consideration, it is, the paper is there to move, it can be implemented by the government. So we're going to produce a kind of a white paper document for the Ministry of Power and the Planning Commission, and it will also go to the office of Dr. Krishnamurthy, and I think I have somebody from the Competition Commission today right here. I exchange cards. So would love to share that with you, because the question is thinking of protection. So it is not protectionism, something else. It is like, I tell you, those countries are giving subsidies which cannot sustain, you know. So we need to look at this discussion in the second half. May I now call Mr. Sunil Parwani, Additional General Manager of Bharat Heavy Electric Limited, to now address this audience, please.
And during last 10 years, have seen a very vast change. If you recollect, till 2005-06, we had never crossed a capacity addition of 5,000 to 6,000 megawatt, which now has crossed 15,000 megawatt per annum. In fact, from 6-7 itself, we jumped from 4,000 megawatt to 7,000 megawatt. And at that time, the major issue which was raised in various forums was the manufacturing capacity. And manufacturing capacity also we were limiting only to the main plant equipment. Subsequently, I am from BHEL. BHEL raised its capacity from 6,000 megawatt, which till the previous year was never even 50% utilized. We went up to 10,000, then 15,000, and now we are 20,000 megawatt. And once the activity started in power sector, number of other joint venture companies with foreign partners, they have set up, and now we expect around 35 to 40,000 megawatt of capacity to be available by 2014-15. Now, one concern everybody is having, not only the equipment's manufacturer, but other players also, whether there would be a load for that much of capacity or not. Incidentally, last year, that is 2011-12, the orders that put together, which have been finalized or placed on various manufacturers, have been under 10,000 megawatt, which included a bulk order which we had been pursuing for last almost 6 years. Of course, the major reason what we were talking about 5 to 6 years back about the plant capacity, that have been resolved, but a number of other issues have come up, and major one being the fuel availability. Of course, with the coal gate so much in news now, hopefully the things, maybe not immediately, but in some time, should improve, and the coal blocks which were lying idle for such a long time, they should start producing, and then again we would be on the fast track. Now, talking about UMPPs, as Mr. Sajdeva said, of course it has been a good move. And the tariff which have been quoted also have been very attractive. But on the other hand, after so many years, even only one unit or two units have been commissioned and only one is producing. So there is a need to relook whether the cheapest option is the best option, or we have to see other viability of the projects also. It may be technical viability, like to obtain the cheapest tariff, cheapest equipment are being sourced, there are compromises on the specifications, and the financial viability also is not, all the contingencies are not considered while working out the financial viability of the project in the long run. And that is what we are seeing, although the orders were booked on tariff-based bidding, the availability of the coal and at what price, they have not been fully considered. So the issue is whether we are interested in the installed capacity only or the availability also. Many of the plants which have been installed, they are not producing. So do we require those type of plants after investment of so much of funds? if they are not able to produce either because of fuel availability or they becoming not non-viable for production. Second thing which I think would be a concern for all the equipment manufacturers and suppliers, particularly at least the domestic suppliers, I would say. When we brought down the custom duty way back in 99 by introducing mega project, at that time there was not many, there was only BHEL who was producing, and the country was aiming ahead of fund scarcity and we were looking for foreign support. But over the years, when we have a capacity much more than what is required, do we still have to have policies which encourage import? Those things need to be analyzed. Although the custom duty which have been recently announced, it is a fallout of the change in the mega policy which took place in 2009 when the price preference was removed. And to compensate for that thing, the custom duty committee was set up to look into the other options. And in 2012, after 3 years, the notification imposing custom duty have come in. Although along with the custom duty, excise duty has also come. So the net benefit which is available to domestic suppliers is very minimal only. So when the 15% price preference was withdrawn in 2009, as against that, what has now actually been available is only 5%, because CVD gets offset by excise duty, SAD gets offset by sales tax. So the difference is coming just to 4 to 5%.